No surprise, but COVID tops our list again this year as the biggest story of 2021. In particular, we want to look at the state's response to the ongoing pandemic, from public health mandates to the vaccination rollout. Let's start there. Algernon, New Mexico continues to have one of the highest vaccination rates in the country, and yet our recent spike in cases has been one of the worst. What do you make of that disconnect? What's going on there?
Well, what health officials are saying is that because New Mexico had so many people get vaccinated early, pretty much as soon as they became available, there was this push to distribute vaccines throughout the state, including the hardest to get to corners. Now we're seeing waning immunity, they feel. And as the virus has spread, mutated, and immunity wanes, you have this prolonged spike in cases. And this is not just New Mexico, a New Mexican problem. This has been a national problem as the virus has moved around. And so now the race is on to figure out how to slow that spread down so that vaccines can get ahead of it, but also to continue having this argument that we're having about how we all, what is expected of all of us as individuals during a public health emergency.
Good point there, yeah. Julianne, Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham recently extended the indoor mask mandate through January 7th. Are those mask mandates still having an impact, or are people just doing what they want to do at this point?
In Santa Fe, I think people are fairly compliant in public spaces, including in outdoor spaces where people are fairly close to one another. You know, I was just looking at some photos from Indian Market over the summer and seeing people and they're kind of varying degrees of feeling like it's important to wear a mask outside. But I think if you go into any Santa Fe business, whether it is a, you know, coffee shop or restaurant or, you know, bookstore or, you know, the Target, everyone is complying with the law. You don't see a lot of arguing about it. You know, but there again, I know we're in somewhat of a bubble here and that's not even the case. When I go to visit, you know, to Harris and Edgewood and those areas, people don't feel the same about it and they're not as willing to comply with the state law.
Are you having an issue still in Santa Fe with folks visiting? I don't want to pick on Texas here, but there was a time where a lot of Texans were coming to Red River, Santa Fe, a lot of northern New Mexico places, and really not having it with the mask mandates by the governor. Is that still happening in Santa Fe?
I mean, I think if you're walking into a business in Santa Fe, you're being asked to wear a mask, and there's very few people who are trying to buck that. If you're out on the sidewalk downtown, you're still very close to people who think that it's okay to just, you know, rip it off when you're outside. That seems to be the sticking point. And again, the law does not require you to wear a mask when you're outside. And so that is the, you know, that's where you see, I think, the most conflict. But the tourists, the visitors, no matter where they're from, when you walk in the front door and there's a sign that says, please put on your mask. I really don't think you can argue with that if you want to do your business there.
Exactly right. Dan McKay, seven hospitals are so overwhelmed with cases that they've moved to crisis standards of care here in New Mexico. How bad would it have to get, do you think, for the governor to go back to even more restrictive conditions like, you know, we saw in the early days of the pandemic?
Well, she has made it pretty clear in her staff. They have all made it pretty clear that they do not want to go back to capacity limits on businesses. You know, how many tools they have at their disposal, you know, is an open question. You know, I think they're trying to do what they can while not, you know, restricting businesses again. You know, the mask mandate has been a point of controversy. I think she's definitely faced some political criticism on that point. But they have not, the administration has not signaled at all that it is interested in moving schools back to remote learning or imposing business restrictions. We'll have to see whether there's anything that changes that.
Algernon, I want to bring back this urban-rural divide question as nowhere that's been more clear than mask and vaccination mandates. Was there something the governor and other leaders could have done differently to try and fight this pandemic back when, while also making rural communities part of the solution and getting buy-in?
Well, I think really the I don't know that there's I think the divide between how rural communities and urban communities understand the risks and the options can be overstated mm-hmm. based on just some of the stereotypes that we hold. I think that for rural communities, really, it was just a matter of having access. Mm-hmm. However people felt about vaccines, however people felt about, you know, the issue remains just access to healthcare services when needed. Mm-hmm. And you know, I think that even is a problem for people in some rural communities. When you have people who live in Las Cruces that need to travel to Albuquerque for some kinds of healthcare, mm-hmm. You know, these problems are not isolated to a community or a particular type of community. They're really shared across the state. Mm-hmm. Likewise with schools, I think that what the pandemic has shown us is just the extent to which schools are dependent upon to deliver a number of services and security for our children mm-hmm. across the state, rural and urban. Mm-hmm. And so I think this is one issue where I think that that line we draw between rural and urban sort of consciousness mm-hmm. of our problems, I think it's a little bit more broad than that. And mm-hmm. Really what is relevant there is just the difference in terms of access right. to information and to services.
Gotcha. Jessica, one of the more infamous, if you want to use that word, mask mandates or mandates, I should say, was regarding the state fair from the governor this past year. Very interesting reaction. Of course, we had the alt state fair for the 4-H kids in Roswell, which seemed to be a big hit, actually. And my big concern is that becomes permanent now that folks have seen there's another way to do these things. But I'm curious, with the state fair particularly, what were you hearing back then? Because, boy, I was hearing some really hard stuff. A lot of folks took this as a personal affront from the governor and really were personally hurt by this.
Well, you're talking about a beloved state tradition, right? So people are going to have very strong feelings about it either way to begin with. Right. But I think you're right. We viewed what happened, that separation, holding our own mini state fair down south as a success. And maybe part of that was at the very beginning, there was a lot of confusion about what would be allowed and not be allowed in terms of being a participant at the state fair, right? What were the rules and regulations that accompanied having our children go out and show their animal at the state fair. We tend to look at it in terms of we're just looking for alternate solutions. We just want to be able to do those normal things that Algernon mentioned before in a normal manner and give those experiences to our kids and to our families and bring them back to our state. I think that if the state persists in mask mandates and vaccination requirements, that you're going to see a lot more people turn to alternate solutions or finding not necessarily ways around it, but ways that they can continue to engage in these activities without the need or the blessing of the state.
Right. Well, it's a tough call down there. It's amazing what happens when you have to, you know, do things that right. is not popular. Dan, go ahead, Jessica, it's my fault.
I'm sorry. I was just going to say it was super encouraging to see, though, how many people participated, but on their own took up this you know, vaccination and mask use themselves.
There you go. Love that. Hey, Dan McKay, the governor's race is already heating up for next year. We all know that, with Governor Michelle Lujan Grisham, of course, seeking re-election. But Kara Cuey, Weatherman Mark Ronchetti jumping into the fray as well. How do you see the COVID pandemic and the governor's response playing into the race?
Oh, I think it'll be a huge issue. It's something that touches every single New Mexican, and you know, these policy choices aren't easy ones to make. And you've even seen, you know, it's not like Democratic governors have all responded the same way. You know, there is debate within, you know, every state over how to handle vaccine mandates and mask mandates and things like that. Mm-hmm. You know, Governor Lujan Grisham has been on the aggressive side when it comes to you know, requiring masks and vaccines. So yes, I do think it'll be a huge issue. And, you know, kind of the broader political environment may favor Republicans, given that there's a Democrat in the White House. That's always kind of a national climate that affects local races. You know, whether that will make the race more competitive than it was last time, you know, we don't know. But COVID almost certainly will be a top issue.
Good point there. What was your top story of 2021? Head to any of our social media channels to let us know. You can find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Now, before we wrap up this week's show, we want to bring you a voice of the future and her thoughts on addressing climate change here in New Mexico. She is a UNM Sustainability Studies student and took part in a recent protest on campus demanding the UNM Foundation divest its interest in fossil fuel industries.